Hello everybody, my name is Jeff Bees and I'm here to talk to you about the Air Velocity Lab for ME4031W. So as a walkthrough of what we're going to cover in this video, we'll start out with the experimental setup, going into the manometry, hot wire anemometry, and velocity profile and jet boundary. And then we'll talk about the procedure broken up into two steps, one for calibration and then the next one for determining the profiles for velocity and turbulence. And then we'll finish off with the results that we expect you to get from this experiment. So we'll start out with the experimental setup. Here's what you'll see when you get into the lab, and here's a top view of your experimental setup. So the first thing that we have is an adjustable blower, which will be producing air velocity for our measurements. And this is attached to an adjustable track right here, which can traverse the radial direction for our measurements. And on the other side of the track, we have both a anemometer probe and a pedostatic tube on the same attachment to the adjustable track, which will allow you to adjust the axial position of your measurement. Now, the pedostatic tube connects to the manometer, providing both a stagnation pressure as well as a static pressure, which will result in a differential pressure reading. The anemometer probe is controlled using the constant temperature anemometer, which has a power supply attached to it, and the output of this will go into the DAC, which will then be read by the LabVIEW program. Some notes about this is that you need to turn on the constant temperature anemometer power supply, and you want to make sure to align the orifice from the adjustable blower into two different positions. One is in front of the pedostatic tube, and then the other is in front of the anemometer probe, and this will happen during your calibration process, so make sure you go back and forth between the two. For the manometry measurements, we have a number of things to incorporate. The first is the adjustable blower, which was made in-house, and therefore there are no specifications that you can look up. There's a dial on there that you can turn in order to adjust the velocity. Do not pay attention to the meter that is shown on the blower due to concerns of accuracy. Rely instead on the manometer reading for a pressure differential. The pedostatic tube operates by having the tube placed within the airstream, and the stagnation point enters through the tube directly, whereas on the sides of the pedostatic tube are ports that allow the static pressure to be measured. From there, the static pressure will follow this line to one side of the differential manometer, and then the stagnation pressure will go down the middle of the pedostatic tube to go to the other side of the differential manometer. And here is the manometer with the stagnation pressure entering through here and the static pressure entering through here. And so as the velocity increases, this red fluid will actually traverse off to the right and then eventually down and will give you a pressure reading in inches of water. In order to operate this manometer, you want to first level the manometer using this bubble level here, which can be adjusted with the knob down here at the bottom right. The knob just above that will be used for zeroing the manometer so that the bubble, when it has zero velocity measured, has the right edge of the bubble aligned with the zero. Another important thing to note about the manometer is that there are two different reading regions. The first one is a inclined manometer region with a finer resolution, and then the vertical region, which allows you to get larger increments but has a poor resolution comparatively. We will also be using a mercury thermometer, which has readings of degrees Fahrenheit, which we'll use to get the ambient temperature reading. The last thing you need to collect is the atmospheric pressure. ME-Net reports the barometric pressure in numerous units, and you'll want to take the inches mercury reading to plug into the LabVIEW program. With all of these components together, you can use the equation provided in the lab manual to determine velocity, noting that the density is a function of the ideal gas law. For the hot wire anemometry, we rely on the use of a hot wire probe, which will be placed within the flow field in order to be cooled convectively by the air flowing across it. And this probe will be controlled using the constant temperature anemometer, which is shown down here, which monitors the temperature of the hot wire probe and maintains that temperature at 250 degrees Celsius. And in order to do that, it provides an increased voltage to compensate for the convective cooling, providing a heat balance. This energy balance allows you to generate King's Law by equating the heating generated by the electricity as well as the cooling from the convection. After a bit of algebra and incorporating things like the Nusselt number, you can eventually get to King's Law, which is E squared equal to A plus B times the square root of U. An important note about this equation is that there's actually natural convection present for zero velocity measurements, and therefore you cannot accurately get readings in that region. The other important thing to note is that because of the relationship between the voltage and the velocity, there is a high sensitivity involved, and therefore when you're taking your readings, you must establish a calibration curve with an R-square of at least 0.99. Now keep in mind when you're doing this calibration process and any of the measurements that the hot wire probe is incredibly fragile and also very expensive, and so try to avoid any contact with the wire itself and be wary of it burning out, because it does do that from time to time, in which case you can contact the TA and they will replace the probe with a new one. In part two of this lab, you'll be generating a velocity profile, and so some important information with regard to the velocity profile is that we will assume that it is axisymmetric, which means that you only need to choose one direction as your radial direction, and you don't need to take measurements on the other side. Now, the velocity profile is considered to be fairly uniform right up next to the orifice, and therefore you want to move the track so that your probe and pedostatic tube is located as close to the orifice as possible in order to ensure good calibration. Now, the jet boundary is defined as the point where the velocity has dropped down to 20% of the velocity that you measured at the axis. And so if we chose a point at, say, z equals 10 centimeters, and the velocity here was 30 meters per second, the velocity at the jet boundary would be 1/5 of that, or in other words, 6 meters per second. Now the jet boundary has a geometric approximation, which is that it is 5 degrees from the axis, or 10 degrees between one jet boundary and the other side of the jet boundary. Something that a lot of people forget is that the orifice actually has a defined diameter, and therefore you need to incorporate an offset in your geometric approximation equal to the orifice radius. We will provide a digital caliper in order to measure that orifice diameter. As I mentioned before, you have an adjustable track, which will allow you to traverse the radial positions as well as the axial positions. On each track, there is actually a ruler, which will allow you to keep track of what position you're measuring at. However, each ruler is not zeroed properly. So the zero point on the z-axis, for instance, will be set at zero at a distance away from the orifice. The radial position corresponds very poorly to the ruler on the radial axis. So you might find that the axis point is found at something like 70 millimeters instead of zero, and so you need to incorporate those offsets. For your measurements, you'll want to measure at least 24 positions, with 4 positions evenly spaced between 5 and less than 50 centimeters. And for each of those axial positions, you'll want to pick 6 radial positions located between and including the center line and jet boundary on one side. In order to determine the radial positions, you'll want to use that geometric approximation to determine where that jet boundary might be, and then increment evenly between the center line and that jet boundary. It is recommended that you come to the lab prepared with those measurement positions chosen. Otherwise, you will need to perform those calculations while you're in the lab, which will add time to your experiment. In application, since the geometric approximation is not precise, if you get to your last position, which should be the jet boundary, and you have not reached less than or equal to 20% of your center line, you will need to take additional radial measurements, so just incrementing out additional points. From there, if you overshoot your radial jet boundary, then you can interpolate to find the proper value. Now we'll move on to the procedure. So the first step to this experiment is that you're going to want to zero and balance your manometer, and then you'll want to turn on the power supply for the anemometer, and then you'll enter into the software end of it, which I have a recording here to describe the process visually in addition to my commentary. So first you'll find the program in Lab 4 and open up the calibration program, and then you will want to select a file path, going into the student data folder and selecting your lab section and the lab that you're in, and take the test file, make a copy of it, and rename it as calibration. And then you'll want to get your barometric pressure reading using MENET, which will give you a reading in inches mercury, and plug that into the program. Then you'll get the thermometer reading located at the front of the room and plug that in. After getting the temperature reading, you'll want to turn the blower on and set the track to its closest position with the orifice placed in front of the pedostatic tube, and adjust the blower until you reach your first differential pressure reading on the manometer, which is 2 inches water. And then you'll want to initialize the DAC and place the orifice in front of the hot wire anemometer, run the program, and then press acquire. Then you'll want to accept the first reading, since the R-square is meaningless here, and wait 8 seconds due to the number of samples and sampling rate, and then check your voltage reading to make sure that it's roughly in the teens. A lower value may indicate a broken anemometer, and the velocity measurements are based upon the input parameters. Once you've verified that the voltage is in a reasonable range, you'll want to place the orifice back in front of the pedostatic tube in order to get your next manometer reading, which will be 1.5 inches water. And then you'll want to move the orifice back in front of the hot wire anemometer probe and click acquire. And now you'll have two data points, which by definition will result in an R-square of 1. From there, you'll want to continue this process for a third measurement, as well as remaining measurements, keeping in mind that now you have to pay attention to the R-squared value to make sure that it is greater than or equal to 0.99. And if the value is less than 0.99, you'll want to reject that reading and check your measurements again to make sure that your reading was accurate. Sometimes you'll think it was 1, but it was actually 0.99 due to the transient nature of the pressure measurements. Sometimes you may need to iterate through a few acquisitions and rejections before you get to an acceptable R-square value. And once you've established an R-square value that is sufficient, you can accept that value and then move on to the remaining values. Once you've finished taking your data, you can stop the program and move on to the next one. Now, one of the issues with this calibration program is that you have to, by default, take the first two measurements without knowing whether or not it's going to produce a good R-square value. And so you may find out that as you move along in your calibration process that one of those two data points was faulty. And the solution to this is that you can retake that measurement and then output that information to something like Excel, and then run an outlier criterion method, such as the Chauvenet criterion, in order to validate the removal of the invalid calibration point. Once you've removed the invalid calibration point, you can perform linear regression in order to get the King's Law coefficients that you will then use in the next program. Then you'll want to open up the velocity profile program and enter in the coefficients that you determined from the calibration program, and then enter in the radial and axial positions. You can either use the actual lengths or use a shorthand like radial position 1 and axial position 1. And then you'll want to select a new file path to save to. Then you'll want to make sure that the orifice is aligned with the hot wire anemometer, which is your 0 point radius, and that your axial coordinate is at the closest position. While at this position, you'll want to increase the blower until you reach a velocity of at least 30 meters per second, which you can verify by running this program and then clicking acquire until you get to that point. You may need to repeat this process several times by rejecting the reading and increasing the blower and continuing that until you get to that 30 meter per second value, and then you want to accept that reading. And then you'll move on to the second radial coordinate and take the new reading while maintaining that blower at that initial setting, all the way through to the end of this experiment. Now, an important note about this is that the 30 meters per second doesn't need to be precise. You just need to be at a high enough magnitude that when you get to your furthest axial position, you're still getting readable measurements. As a reminder, once you get out to your furthest radial coordinate that you've determined previously, and if your velocity measurement is not at least lower than 1/5 of your centerline velocity, or 20% of your centerline velocity, you need to take additional radial coordinates. And you can increment that out by the same delta R that you used for your first 6 data points. Once you've done that for all the axial positions, you are done taking your measurements. So now we'll move on to the deliverables. So what you should get from these measurements is a calibration plot given in e squared versus square root of u. The second item is a velocity profile, including the jet boundary. So the axes should be radius and axial coordinates. You can indicate velocity by using horizontal error bars and only having a value present on the right side. And then you can actually change the end cap type, if you're using Excel, into an arrow, which will make it look like a velocity vector. In order to do this, make sure you include a scale that converts from centimeters to meters per second. Also on this plot, you'll want to have the experimental and theoretical jet boundary. From there, you can determine the jet boundary angle as well as the orifice radius using the information given from the linear regression for slope and intercept, which will also allow you to determine their uncertainties. The last item that you'll want to include is the turbulence intensity plot, which involves the turbulence, which is defined as the standard deviation of the velocity, and you'll want to normalize that with respect to the centerline velocity. The x-axis will just be the radial coordinate that the measurement occurred at, divided by the jet boundary radius for that axial position. This will involve creating 4 different series, one for each axial position, that you'll want to make clear on the plot. That's everything I have for you. I hope this has been helpful and that you have a wonderful day.